Thank you, everyone, and good morning. This topic about fundamental analysis, like when you read this topic, what do you have in mind, and what do you expect from this session? Anyone? Okay. I want to show you something that is interesting before I go to the agenda. Yeah. What's not moving? Oh. Okay. Okay, so this is Apple stock chart, yeah, from January 2018 to December 21st 2018, last year. Yeah, you see that on 21st December 2018, the price is the lowest in the whole year. Okay, so if you were to have a chance to buy Apple stock during this date, how do you decide whether you are going to buy, whether this is a good bargain or this is a failing stock? Yeah, so basically what I'm going to present here is how can you get a quick snapshot of a business. Yeah, so there's another case here which also interesting. Okay, this one, maybe some of you familiar with Wirecard. This is a payment vendor, so when you pay something, usually your payment will be handled by Wirecard. It's a German company. Yeah, this year, around month of February, the stock price falling around 30% in less than 2 weeks. Okay, so how do you decide quickly, right? Whether is this a good buying or not? Yeah. Okay. So before I go to the code, yeah, I want to explain a little bit about fundamental analysis. Is there anyone familiar with value investing or fundamental analysis? Okay, yeah, okay. So for fundamental analysis, right, there are many ways for you to analyze a stock, analyze a company. Okay, we cannot say that one way is the correct way and the other way is the wrong way. Okay, so what I will present here, if you are already familiar with value investing, will be debatable. Yeah, some of you might agree or some of you might be disagree. Okay, so when we talk about value in investing, right, we are trying to evaluate the business. Yeah, is this a good business? Yeah, or not? Yeah, I put into full screen so it's easier to see. Okay, so when you want to buy stock, right, if you are using value investing or fundamental analysis, you want to see whether the business is a good business or not. Yeah, is the business healthy or not? Yeah, does it have too much debt that someday it could not pay? Yeah, if it's healthy, how much does it earn? Okay, and then does the business grow or not? Okay, and then the last thing that you want to find out is how much is its fair value. Okay, because when you see the price in the market, yeah, it's sometimes it's not its real value. So in value investing, we differentiate between price and value. Price is what you pay. Okay, value is the value of the company. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So basically, the goal is to get a fundamental snapshot of a business. Yeah. We are going to use a simple framework that can be automated. Okay. So this is the framework that I'm going to use. Yeah. Okay. I have four principles for this talk. Yeah. The most important thing of a business are the leaders. Yeah. Like if you are taking a taxi, right? Your safety depend on the driver. Yeah. So you must ensure that the leaders of the business are good people. Yeah. So we have four principles here. Yeah. We need to be sure that it has a low debt. Okay. Debt equity ratio. I will explain this. Yeah. About this ratio. And then it's a solvent business. Yeah. It has a high liquidity. It can pay its short-term obligation. Okay. It has a strong and consistent return. And you need to ensure that the management are paid properly. Okay. And then principle two, that we want the business to have a long-term prospect. Yeah. It has a persistent products. Yeah. That don't die easily. Yeah. And it has an economic moat. Yeah. Later I will explain this one by one. Okay. And then a company must be stable. Yeah. It has a stable book value, BV growth. This is also a ratio that I will explain later. Yeah. And then it has a positive earning per share growth. Okay. And then the last principle. Yeah. Where we want to buy at a cheap price. Yeah. How do we determine that a stock price is cheap? Yeah. We can use the four principle here. Yeah. Low PE and then low PB. Okay. And then we will calculate the intrinsic value and margin of safety later. Yeah. Okay. So let's go to this. Understanding basic fundamental ratios. Anyone familiar with fundamental ratios? Okay, bear with me for a while. Yeah, this is not easy, but I will try to explain you in a very simple term. Okay, so let's say this is a business, right? When you start a business, you will have assets. Yeah, assets could be cash. Yeah, it could be a car. It could be a property. It could be inventory. Yeah. Usually a business you also have liabilities. Okay. So let's try to understand these three simple concepts: assets, liabilities. Okay. And then equity is basically you just subtract assets from liabilities. Okay. That's the equity. Basically, equity is how much the business worth. In accounting terms, yeah, it's on paper value of the business, yeah, but it doesn't represent the price in stock market. Okay, so asset, liabilities, and equity. Anyone have question here? Easy to catch up. Okay. Okay. So you okay, and then let's say your business is growing, right? And then you want to get additional funding from retail investor. So you go public, okay? You go public and then you issue, let's say 1,000 shares, okay? That public can buy. So in this case, we say that total share outstanding is 1,000, okay? So we have four concepts now. You have asset, you have liabilities, and then you have equity and total share outstanding. Okay, now I want to introduce this, the first ratio, book value per share. Okay. Okay, so we already have asset, liabilities, and equity, right? You already know how to get the numbers, right? How to get equity? You subtract liabilities from asset. Okay, you get the equity, and then you have total share outstanding. So BV, basically you just divide equity divided by total share outstanding. Okay. I will give you a link to download the PPT later. Yeah, don't worry. Okay, so in this case, the BV of this our example business is $38. Everyone can follow until here. So you already know asset, liabilities, equity, total share outstanding, and BV ratio. Okay, we will use this BV ratio in one of our principle later. Okay, so try to, understand. Okay. Okay. Market cap. Okay. So BV is this one. When I say BV, business value, is basically book value per share. Okay. But book value per share that not always the same with share price. Okay, it could be valued differently in the market. It could be lower, it could be higher. Okay, so let's say this share, right, it's traded in the market for $40, for $40. Okay, it has 1,000 total share outstanding. Okay, the market cap is defined as total share outstanding multiplied by price per share. Okay, everyone can follow until here? Yeah, so you have asset, you have liabilities, you have equity, you have total share outstanding, you have market cap, you have BV. Yeah, you have six term now already. Okay, yeah. Okay, price to book ratio. So we already have BV, right? BV ratio, right? BV, book value, is basically, remember, equity you divide by total share outstanding. Yeah. So price to book ratio, basically you divide share price in the market to book value per share. Okay. Anyone have question? Does it make sense? Okay. So basically, book value per share is the share price on paper. Yeah. It doesn't reflect the price in the market. Okay. It's just based from your accounting concept. Yeah. The value of the business. Okay. Okay, so I want to ask you a question, right? Which one is better? You have a PB that is greater than one or PB lower than one?
For buying or for sell? For sell or for buy?
For buying.
Less.
Anyone can follow? Why? Why PB? Why if PB is less than one, we consider it as cheap? Yeah. So let's say, for example, I give you a simple example. Okay. This is the example that usually everyone can easily understand. A property, right? When you buy an HDB, right? You have a buy price, right? Buy price is the price that offered by the owner. Yeah. So let's say you want to buy HDB, which is 500,000. The price is 500,000. Okay. But then a valuer will come, right? A third party valuer will come to the HDB. Yeah. to value the property, right? So if the valuer give a business value of 400,000, do you think the property is cheap or expensive? The price is 500,000, but the valuation is 400,000. It's expensive, right? Why? Because the price is above the book value. Okay? So when PB is greater than 1, it means the price on the market is greater than its book value. Okay? When PB is less than 1, it means you buy a property that is valued 500,000, but the price is, let's say, 400,000. It's cheap, right? Yeah. Okay. Until here, you understand the concept of book value and PB. Yeah. Okay. So here you learn so many concepts. You have equity. You have liabilities. You have total share outstanding. You have price to book ratio. Okay. Okay. Now, this concept, debt to equity. Okay. For example, let's say this XYZ company, right? It has this balance statement like this. It has assets, yeah, where the total is 2,000. And then it has liabilities where the total is 1,500. Okay, how much is the equity of this business?
$500,
right? Asset minus liabilities. Okay. And then we want to check whether this business is healthy or not. Does it have too much debt or not? Okay. So the way we calculate DE is debt to equity ratio is total liabilities we divide by equity. So if total liabilities is 1,500 and the equity is 500, how much is the DE?
3.
Correct? You divide. Yeah, it means, what does it mean if DE is 3? It means for every $1 of share that you own as a shareholder, for every $1 of share that you own, yeah, you owe $3 to a creditor. So do you think it's a good business or not? Compared to let's say the DE is 0.5. Yeah, if a DE is 0.5, it means every $1 share you have in the company, you owe the creditor 0.5. So which one is better, DE 3 or DE 0.5? 0.5, right? Okay. Yeah, it's something like you buy a property, you buy a business from an owner, right? Let's say the business is $5,000, but then it has obligation which is $1 million. It's not a good business, right? If the debt is higher than the equity, okay. So in our first principle, right, we want to buy a healthy company. Yeah, we aim for the DE less than 0.5. Okay, so this number is debatable, right? Some people think that we should not put a value there, but instead we should compare across industry. Yeah, so let's say if it's a software company, we have to compare the DE with other software companies instead of putting 0.5 here. Yeah, so I just put this 0.5 to make it simpler. Yeah. Okay. So high DE is not a good indicator because it indicates that a company may not be able to generate enough cash to pay its debt. Yeah. Okay. So now I want to show you how we calculate this. Yeah, so this is our principle, right? We want to have low DE, and then we want to have high current ratio. Okay, we want to what is this high current ratio? Okay, so current ratio. So current ratio is defined by total current assets divided by total current liabilities. Current asset, it means the assets that you can sell quickly within 1 year. Yeah, for example, you have a car. Usually car can be easily sold within 1 year, right? Yeah, it's we consider it a current asset. Okay, and then current liabilities also a debt that you must pay within 1 year. Yeah, so this current ratio, right, basically this is to understand how liquid is the company. I mean, if it has a short-term debt, right, will it be able to pay or not? Yeah. Okay, so high current ratio means that a company should be able to meet its short-term debt, short-term obligation. Yeah. So we aim for current ratio 1.5, yeah, as a guide. Okay. And then, sorry. And then we want to buy a strong and consistent return, a business with a strong and consistent return. Okay, so I want to introduce you the concept of return on equity. Yeah, so okay, so you already understand DE and current ratio, right? Now I want to explain to you about this return on equity. So a business will have revenue, right? Annual revenue, and then it will also have expenses. Yeah, this is you understand this, right? Revenue and expenses, right? And it could also have profit. Yeah, equity, you already understand. Yeah, so ROE or return on equity is basically net profit divided by equity. So net profit, I think probably you already understand, right? Net profit margin, it means net profit divided by revenue. Yeah, so for example, if the business is profitable, right, the profit for this year is 10,000, yeah, but the revenue is 50,000, it means the net margin is basically around 20%. Yeah, it's something like you buy a property for 400,000, right? And then you sell it for 480,000. Yeah, you have net margin $80,000, which is 20%, right? That is your net profit margin. Okay? And then when you want to calculate ROE, you just divide net profit with equity. Yeah, you get the number. So if there are two businesses, right, one is with ROE 5%, and then the second one has ROE 26%, which business is better? 26%, right? Because it could generate higher net profit margin. Does it make sense? Okay, you can follow. Okay, yeah. And then earning per share, right? So so earning per share is basically for $1 share that you pay, right, how much earning that you will get. Yeah, so in this example, right, the profit is 10,000, and then the company doesn't pay dividend. Yeah, and then we divide by total share. Yeah. So earning per share, earning per share is $10. Do you think is a good business or not? If the share price is $40, right? So for every $40 that you pay, yeah, for a share, every year you will get $10. This is what it means by earning per share. Yeah. So if you pay for $40 for the share, right? Every year you will get $10 every year. Okay, that is earning per share. Yeah. Okay. So now let's go to our code. Yeah. We want to try to calculate this with Python and Pandas. Yeah. Okay. So there are many API out there that can provide you with stock data. Yeah. So you can consume this API using your Python and Pandas, right? And then you can easily calculate all the ratios with Pandas, yeah. So the setup is you put the import statement, and then here I use an API from Intrinio. Okay, it provides an API key, and then you need to mention what kind of stock that you want to see the data, yeah. Here I want to see stock data for Apple, AAPL, yeah, the stock code. Okay. Okay. We go to our principle one, right? We want to check whether this business has a low DE or not. Okay. So we run this. Yeah. You see that the DE is 1.12. Yeah. Actually, it's if we follow our guide before, which is 0.5, it's a little bit high. Yeah. Okay. So it what does it mean? This DE, right? It means for every $1 of Apple share that you own, yeah, the company owe the creditor $1.12. Okay, now we want to calculate the current ratio. Okay, how solvent is Apple? Okay, we want to see that, you see, the current ratio is 1.5, so it actually fulfills our guide. Yeah, we want a share that the current ratio is more than 1.5. yeah. Okay, so it means for every dollar of short-term debt that Apple has, yeah, the company has $1.5 to pay it. Yeah, so it's quite liquid. Okay, it can meet its short-term obligation. Okay, and then we want to calculate the return on equity. Yeah. So when we calculate the return on equity, usually we will calculate the last 5 years historically. Okay, we want to see how it grows over time. Okay. So what we do is we call the API. Yeah, it doesn't look pretty. Yeah. So we want to make it a little bit neat by printing as a table. Okay. Here you see for every year, yeah, it shows you how much is the ROE. Okay, this is also not pretty neat, yeah, because we want to change the date short by date, right, to ascending. Okay, now if we plot we can plot it, but the axis is still not correct, yeah, because it started with the current year instead of a previous year. Yeah, so we want to make it a little bit easier. Yeah, we sort by date. Yeah, ascending. Okay, and then okay, we get already we sorted by year. Yeah, so here we go. We have the return on equity. So basically, the return on equity is not always consistent, right? Because in 2015, the ROE is quite high, which is 45%. 2018, it's also quite high, but 2017, it's not as high as 2018. Okay. Then we want to calculate the average of the ROE, right? We see that the ROE in average grows 12% annually. Yeah. So let's say we have a guide that we want a company where the ROE growth is more than 8% annually. Yeah. Any question so far? Yeah. So basically, what this
are? Yeah. Wait, how do you know how big the debt of the company is?
From here, from okay, how big the debt? Yes, it's a public data. So every company that goes public, right, they will publish their financial statement. Yeah, in the financial statement, then you can see their assets, their debts, liabilities, right, their profit, yeah, their expenses, everything about their financial. Okay.
Is yep. there a real percent change custom function that you define?
No, this is, I'm just using this pandas mean function. If you see this one, yes, yeah, this one, right? There's this mean function here to calculate the change.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
And this is all part of the pandas.
Yeah, this is part of the pandas. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So what this ROE means, yeah, it means for every dollar equity that you own in Apple, right, every year it will grow 8%. Yeah. So let's say you buy Apple share for $10,000 this year, right? The next year it will grow into $10,000 plus 8% multiplied by $10,000. Okay. Yeah. So in 5 years, right, your equity will grow 40%. Yeah. So this is something like when you buy a property, right? The valuation is 400,000, right? So the book value is 400,000, right? But after, let's say, after 5 years, it grows into 500,000. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I know this is not. I mean, if you just hear this concept just today, this is not really easy concept to grasp. Okay. Okay. So the rule number four, appropriate management incentive. This one, it's not really easy to find data, yeah, because you need to find because some of the companies they don't publish their management salaries, yeah. Some companies they publish, right, but some company don't, yeah. So. Appropriate usually that we compare the executive salary with with salary from other executives in the same industry. Yeah, if it's lower, but if it's too much lower, we need to be careful. Yeah, because if we don't pay the company executive properly, then sometimes they will not maximize shareholder value. Okay, and then we go to the principle number two. A company must have a long-term prospect. Yeah, long-term prospects means that the product has I would say it's like a Coca-Cola, right? Coca-Cola, we say Coca-Cola is persistent products. Why? Because even during recession, people still drink Coca-Cola, right? Or even there are many competitor of Coca-Cola, right? People still buying Coca-Cola. It's not a business that easily going down. Yeah, it's not something like mobile phone, right? Mobile phone. Every year you will change model. Yeah, so it's easily. It's not persistent compared to like drinks like Coca-Cola. Okay, so how do you know that a product is persistent? Yeah, so we can tell from the revenue. Yeah, does the revenue grow or not over the years? If the revenue decrease, it means that people don't buy the products anymore. Yeah, slowly people decrease their consumption of the product. Yeah, we don't want to buy that kind of business. Okay, so we want to buy a business where the revenue always grow. So okay, we can calculate here. Yeah, by calling our API. Okay, and then we want to print. Yeah, so if you see here, right, Apple revenue always grow, except in 2016. Yeah, it's decreasing in the revenue. Okay. And then we want to display it as a graphic, so it's easy to visualize. Yeah, you see 2014 and 2015 is a good year for Apple. Yeah. Okay. And then principle number three, a company must be stable and understandable. Okay. Stable. How do we know a company is stable? Usually, we value from the book value. The book value must grow over time. Okay. You still remember how to calculate book value?
Total, you divide total equity to total share outstanding.
Yeah. Okay. So here we were trying to check the BV. Does the BV grow or not? Okay. So here you see that the BV grows, always grow, right? Except 2014.
Yeah, in 2014 the value is going down a little bit.
Okay, so if we plot it, yeah, you could see that it's growing. Yeah, and then we want to calculate the average. Yeah, so every year the BV grows
around 3%. Yeah.
Okay, and then we want to calculate the earning per share. Yeah. For the last 6 years, yeah. Then we want to plot to see. Yeah, we can see that the earning per share is growing. Is this good or not? If the earning per share is increasing.
let's say you buy Apple share for $100, right? And this year the earning is $10 per share. Yeah. But last year the earning is $20 per share. So which one is better? Low EPS or high EPS? You want to find a stock with high EPS, right? High earning per share. Yeah, it means for every dollar that you invest in the company, you get more money, you get more profit. Okay, and then this is we want to see if this Apple stock is attractive or not. Is it cheap or not? Yeah. So we'll calculate. Yeah. Okay. So for the last 6 years, right? The PE is not the lowest. Yeah. 2018, the PE is not the lowest. The lowest is 2015. Yeah. So we cannot say that 2018 is the cheapest price for Apple. Yeah. But definitely this is cheaper than 2017. Yeah. Okay. And then you want to calculate to plot its PE. Yeah. So here the PE is pretty high. Yeah.
Then it grows in 2019, it's
getting higher. Yeah. So we could say that the price of Apple price on 2018 is cheaper compared to this year. Yeah.
Okay.
So we cannot say that this year the price of Apple share is cheap. Okay, then we want to calculate price to book ratio. Yeah. We are looking for a low price to book ratio. Okay, 2018 it's 6.3. It cannot be considered cheap as well, right? Compared to the previous years. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. And then we want to calculate how much is the intrinsic value of the stock. Yeah. We know the price, but we want to know how much actually it's really worth as a business. Yeah. So there are several methods to calculate intrinsic value, right? There is this PE method. Yeah. And then there's another method which is EPS method. Yeah. There's another method which is this discounted cash flow. Yeah, but I'm not going to discounted cash flow because it's pretty complex. Yeah. So let's try to calculate. Yeah. How much is this stock really worth? Yeah. Okay, so we calculate the PE ratio for the last 5 years. Yeah, and then we average. And then we multiply by earning per share. Okay.
Okay. So the EPS is 11.87.
The average. Okay. So
we calculate the intrinsic value based on the EPS. Yeah. So the intrinsic value is 169. Yeah.
How much is the Apple price today?
Okay, it's 230 in the market now. Yeah. Okay. Okay, now we want to okay, 237. Okay, now we want to calculate intrinsic value based on the last EPS. Yeah, so this one, right? Based on the last EPS, we calculate that it's 169. Yeah, so the current price is 227. So we could say that Apple is overvalued. Yeah, the price is much higher than the intrinsic value. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we want to calculate margin of safety. This must be negative. Okay, negative 34. So we can say that the current price, the Apple current price, which is 227, is expensive. Yeah, we don't want to dig deeper into the financial statement. Okay, now let's say I have another stock, right? That I want to see the value. Yeah, let's say I want to see how good is Microsoft, right? I can just change the stock quote, yeah, and then I can do run all. Okay, it will calculate everything for us. You see, the DE is low, 0.7, yeah, and then current ratio is high, 2.5, right, much higher than Apple, yeah, and then how is this ROE? Yeah, you see the ROE growth, yeah. For the last six years, the ROE growth is 21%. Yeah, so this is considered better than Apple. Okay, so then if you go down, yeah, you see the revenue growth. Yeah. Okay, it's growing in revenue, except in 2018. Yeah, the revenue is going down. Okay, and then how about the stability of its book value? Yeah, if you see that the book value per share is growing from 2016. Yeah. Yeah. And then the average growth is 6.9%, almost 7%. Yeah. And then if we calculate the earning per share, yeah, it also grows. Okay. Then how about the intrinsic value? Okay, we calculate the PE. Yeah. This is the PE. The PE in 2018 is very low compared to the 2017. Yeah, even in 2019 it's still pretty low, right? Compared to 2017. Yeah, so yeah, maybe this is worth looking. Okay, and then if you see the price to book ratio, yeah, it's not considered low. Yeah, it's growing. Yeah, it's growing every year. Okay, and then how much is the intrinsic value? Yeah, if we calculate here, the intrinsic value is 155. Okay, but the share price currently is 138. Okay, so this is also we could say this is Yeah, so we could say that Microsoft stock is undervalued right now. Yeah, because the share price in the market is lower than its intrinsic value, which is 155. Yeah, so this could be a better buy compared to Apple. And then we calculate the margin of safety, which is 11%. Yeah. It means if our calculation is wrong, we still have 11% as a buffer. Okay. Any question so far? Second? Amazon. Do we still have time? We don't, yeah. Huh? Okay. Amazon must be pretty high. Yeah. I'm using staging data, ITG data, which is free, right? The free version, they don't have data for all the stock. Yeah, let's see if they have for Amazon or not. Yeah, I will try to run this. If it doesn't have Amazon, then it will break. Oh, you see, company not found. Yeah.
Okay.
I will provide the slide deck. Yeah, but based on the slide deck, then you can create your own calculation. Okay. So here is the you can download the slide deck here.
Pandas is responsible for getting the data on each company as well.
Correct.
You have to fill out the URL.
Yeah, you just go to Intrinio. Yeah, they have free and they have a paid account. Yeah, but not only Intrinio. I mean, Google also have their API. Right, there are so many APIs free. Even some of them are free. Yeah. Okay, if you want to download the deck, it's there, yeah. And then please don't treat this as investment advice, okay? Yeah. Okay. If no question, any question?
Do you guys have any question for Mr. Christianto?
Yep. Update. For example, sorry.
So when do I get like balance sheet data from Apple?
Oh, okay. So usually a public company, right? They will publish their financial statement every quarter. So every 3 months, this data will change. The DE, the debt, equity, etc. Yeah. But they also have daily change, like for example the price, right? It will change every day. The volume will change daily as well.
Yep. Do you have a feedback loop in your system?
Hmm? Say again?
Do you have a feedback loop in your system?
Feedback loop.
For example, if your system tells you to buy, but after you buy, the stock keeps on plummeting down, would you change your system?
Okay. So this notebook, right, is basically just to get a quick snapshot only, yeah. But if you are a real value investor, right, usually you will dig into the financial statement. There's a manual work that you need to do, yeah. Why you want to do that? Yeah. For example, if you see the net profit margin is high, yeah. Let's say net profit margin is 40. Last year is only 10%, yeah. But this year, it grows to 50%. What happened? Yeah, this is when you want to dig into the financial statement, yeah, because it could be because of they sell an asset. Let's say they sell their other businesses, right? That's why the net profit margin is growing. But actually, it's not a good profit because you get the profit not from the daily operational, yeah, but it's because you are selling your asset. So that does it answer your question?
Any more questions? If you guys have, if not, then if you guys still have any more questions, and you may find Mr. Christianto during the lunch break.
Yep.
So with that, I think we can end this right now. So thank you for your attention, and please help me give a hand to Mr. Christianto.
Thank you. I hope it's useful.